My castaway this week is a composer. His music has entertained a generation, making him one of the most successful and almost certainly the richest British musician who's ever lived. He went to Westminster School and then up to Oxford, but chose to leave after only a term to pursue his musical career. Like some of the great composers in history, he decided to write almost exclusively for the theatre, where his work could be enjoyed by everyone. And so it's proved. Joseph and his amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat, Jesus Christ Superstar, Evita, Cats, Phantom of the Opera, they're just some of the shows which have transformed the world of musical theatre. Their creator, showman, art collector, food writer, is a man who wants to be judged above all by his work. "I just love musicals and I love the theatre," he says, "and I want to make sure they go on." He is Lord Lloyd Webber. Why the musical theatre, Andrew? I mean, it might have been pop, it might have been classical, sacred chamber, but you chose the musical. Why?
Well, I was always fascinated by musical theatre from the very, very word go. My aunt was an actress, not a particularly successful one, but I thought her world was unbelievably glamorous, and she used to take me to see some of the American musicals, which were, of course, later in Britain than they were, of course, in New York. And so I got to see an awful lot of things very early on. It just grabbed me, and opera grabbed me. It's just one of those things.
You say opera grabbed you, but I mean, it was very much more musical theatre, as we're saying, than it was opera, which it might have been. Although Evita was classed as an opera, wasn't it?
Well, sort of. I mean, most of my musicals are through composed, or if they have got dialogue, there tends to be music underscoring it. In fact, I find that very satisfying, because if you do that right that way, you're controlling really the evening. And I think that the composer has to control the evening. It's construction in musical theatre that's so vitally important. You could have a great song in the wrong show in the wrong place, and it just wouldn't land.
But it's interesting. I think the ENO, English National Opera, did want to put on Evita. Lord Harwood wanted to put it on, didn't he?
They did, yes. Then they asked me at the roundabout that time if I would write something. And I kept thinking that, what's the point if I can get what I can do in the commercial theatre? It just is a whole layer of other things.
But is it also about reaching most of the people most of the time, or more of the people more of the time anyway, that you actually take a pride, enjoy the fact that your shows are the favourites of the coach parties, young and old?
I do, yes, I do like the fact that people can, you know, that they're accessible. But of course, if you were to write for an opera house, the reason why one would do it would be because you get resources and things that you could not get in the commercial theatre. But everything is changing so fast now, you see. I mean, the amazing electronic arsenal of instruments that one can have means that you can really recreate, with a very small orchestra, sounds that you absolutely would not be able to do even if you had a big one.
But what you've got to have underlying it all are good tunes. And I mean, you know, whether it was Richard Rodgers or Puccini, indeed, you've got to send them away humming.
Tunes and rhythm, I think. I think both are very important.
But how easy is it? I mean, it's the impossible question. How do you write a good tune? Does it just pop into your head? Do you sit and work at it?
I don't know. I mean, I had a hit last year with a song called No Matter What, and I remember when I wrote that tune, I mean, I just wrote it, and I thought, I just don't know where this comes from. And, of course, you suddenly get yourself into a flat panic and think, well, somebody must have done that before. So you then check and check and check. And with that sort of one, it's so instant. And I can't explain where it comes from.
Because people do sometimes say that yours are derivative, you know, that it's an influence of Puccini or Ravel or Mendelssohn's violin concerto or whatever. But I suppose that's inevitable, isn't it?
Well, I think it is inevitable, really, when you're writing very, very primal melodies and they're very, very simple. Because, you know, but yet, the extraordinary thing is that they still seem to come. I mean, you do hear tunes by people, you know, which you say, well, that has to have been done before, but it hasn't.
But where do you get, I mean, take memory, for example. Where did memory come from? How quickly did it come is really what I want to know.
Well, memory is a slightly oddball one, because it wasn't written for cats at all. I had an idea some years ago about writing an opera, a funny opera, about rivalry, which was going to be about the story of Leoncavallo and Puccini both racing each other to write La Bohème, because they both did. So, I of course, it's Puccini-esque, because it was meant to be. And I took it to my father, and my father was a great expert on Puccini, and I said, "What does this sound like, Daddy?" He said, "It sounds like an awful lot of money to me."
Thank you. Tell me about your first record.
Well, I'm a great lover of Prokofiev because he is such a superb melodist apart from anything else. Superb orchestrator, of course. And funny enough, I wanted to choose the March from the Love for Three Oranges because it was the first LP that I was ever given. My father gave Julian and I this album, and I think he wanted us to hear Casse-Noisette, which was on the other side. But Julian and I immediately flipped it, and we found this kind of cacophonous Prokofiev, because it's one of Prokofiev's more sort of outrageous pieces, or the start of it. But of course, the March for the Love Three for Three Oranges is just one of the great tunes of all time, and unmistakably Prokofiev.
Part of the march from Prokofiev's The Love for Three Oranges, played by the Dallas Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Eduardo Mata. Prokofiev made a huge impression on you as a small boy, Andrew, but so did Rock Around the Clock, didn't it? And that's the point, that you were always straddling the two, the classical and the pop.
My father was, although he was the director of the London College of Music, he really didn't mind what was going on in the house musically, providing it was, you know, really quite good. My father actually loved pop. I mean, I remember once he said to me that some record by the Shadows, I think it might have been Brighton City or something, was proved that the Shadows were one of the great chamber groups. I mean, if it was a great tune, he loved it. I mean, you know, I used to like Roy Orbison a lot, the Everly Brothers and everything. He got it completely.
And this all went on in the flat that you lived in South Ken.
Yeah, everything. I mean, it really didn't matter whether it was John Lill moved in at one point, the pianist. And I mean, it could be, of course, I learned a lot with John because, of course, I turned the pages for him. Mm. I remember when he was doing the 7th Pianist Sonata, that incredible 7/8 time. Very nearly took that, actually. But, that da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, fantastic piece of writing.
And Julian was practising the cello and many other instruments as well. So, I mean, a huge cacophony. And Grandma lived in this flat as well,
didn't she? Yes, she did, and Tim Rice did for a bit. It was.
And Grandma was deaf and had the television turned up very loudly.
Well, no, she wasn't. She wasn't that deaf. I mean, one of the funniest stories I remember once was Julian was practising and I was with Tim and we went out of the door. We went downstairs and this guy shot out of the flat and there was Julian playing his cello. And he said, I don't mind the pianist. He said, I don't mind all this rock and roll. I don't mind that. It's this oboe player I can't stand.
But you all live together. Very creative noise. How old were you when you wrote your first piece of music? I mean, perhaps before all this noise began.
Well, it was quite early because my father collected a few of my tunes and got them published when I was about 8 years old. And it came out under the name of the Toy Theatre because I built myself a toy theatre where I staged ghastly musicals written by me. In fact, one of the tunes appears in Joseph.
Really?
Yes.
So it had survived?
Yes, it survived.
Which one is it?
It's Potiphar.
Good heavens. But your father as well wrote, didn't he? He wrote under various pseudonyms.
Well, he was a composer really completely out of his time. I mean, he was like a kind of Pre-Raphaelite painter, you know, trying to paint in the 1930s and 40s, you know, and there were people like that. In fact, he was a wonderful, wonderful melodist. I very, very nearly wanted to take one of his. I mean, he wrote a piece called Aurora, which is just extraordinary. I mean, it's erotic and I mean, I just think it's one of the most fantastic pieces of music. And he we discovered, Julian discovered, an awful lot of music that he'd never let on that he'd composed.
And was that, as I understand it, because he had a kind of inferiority complex about it, because he didn't think perhaps his colleagues at the Royal College of Music would approve, that it was really rather romantic, bit slushy?
Yeah, well, not only that, I think. You see, he was a working-class boy. He got a scholarship to the college. And I think in those days, things were very much more conventional. And I think he thought that the family and everybody around him would think it was a bit below him if he revealed a lot of this stuff. I mean, he wrote a lot of church music, which, of course, he was known for and was very proud of. And that was obviously publicly known. But there was a huge other side to him. And I think he would have made one of the great, great film composers, because he had that breadth. Mm. And the tunes are there.
Record.
Well, this is Some Enchanted Evening, which is arguably one of the greatest tunes ever written. In fact, my father played this to me, and he said, if ever you get near this melody, he said, I really will be proud of you. But this thing about Some Enchanted Evening is it is the essence, absolute essence of melody.
Enchanted evening, you may see a stranger, you may see a stranger across a crowded room, and somehow you know even then. at somewhere you'll see her again. Some enchanted evening, someone may be laughing. You may hear her laughing across a crowded room. And night after night, as strange as it seems, the sound of her laughter will sing in your dreams. Who can explain it? Who can tell you why? Fools give you reasons, wise men never. Enchanted evening, when you find your true love, when you feel her call you across a crowded room, then fly to her side and make her your own.
Some Enchanted Evening from Roger and Hammerstein's South Pacific, sung or not, as the case may be, by Rosanna Bratsy. You say not.
Well, I don't think it was. I think it was somebody called Giorgio Tozzi.
Who sang for him.
Who actually sang for him, yes. I think it was in the days when you dubbed. I don't think our man Rosano was actually a bass baritone.
Just tell me, right from those early days when you were doing your toy theatre with a kind of revolving stage, which was a kind of gramophone.
It was a gramophone turntable. Which
like
had been
last Sunday night at the London Palladium.
Yes.
With
I mean,
all
I'm heavily
waiting.
Influenced, I'm sure.
Did you also perform?
Yes. And a sort of very squeaky, high-pitched little voice.
Is there in you, because, you know, you do everything to do with your shows, but you don't perform. I mean, you obviously recognise that's not what you do, but you would like to, huh?
No, not really, you know.
There's a bit of a performer in you, isn't there?
I mean, only sort of at a certain time of the evening when certain juices have flowed. I wouldn't want to, you know, do a show or be in a show, really, because it kind of, for me, get very repetitive.
Mm. Nevertheless, when you're rehearsing and directing a show or taking part in the production, as it were, it seems to me that part of the showman in you knows what it wants, obviously, from the people on the stage, so that you can tell the Elaine Pages, you know, the
yes.
David Essex.
Although I never pretend to be a director. I mean, I always think when you get into a musical that the director then has to be the king, and that when you've actually appointed the director, at that point you've got to stand behind what, you know, he or she wants to do.
I bet you don't always do that.
I actually do, funnily enough. I really keep my... It's quite a strict rule for me, because I don't think you can undermine somebody. For example, in Whistle Down the Wind, Gail Edwards directed it in London. I personally was not that happy with the design, because it was on two levels, and I always worry about designs on two levels. But she was passionate to have that design and that set, and she was right. Mm. And, you know, therefore, it was right to let her have her... Say.
The one thing that you've always freely admitted you can't do in all of these shows is the lyrics. I presume you've tried.
I have tried, but I don't think it's very wise for them to be exposed to a wider public. I don't really want to. I find one of the things that is most exciting about musical theatre is that, in fact, it is probably the most collaborative of all the mediums you could possibly think of.
Mm.
You know, I find collaboration very exciting. I mean, I'm writing at the moment with Ben Elton, who's a new one for me. It is actually thrilling because he's a completely different mind, completely fresh to musical theatre, and is actually an excellent lyricist. But it's the fact that it's you know, a new tone of voice, something I've never had before, and that I found very exciting.
It's the cross-fertilisation. Each time is different, and therefore something different erupts. Let's go back to an early one, though. Let's Tim Rice enter into this Lloyd Webber story. Wonderful line here. He wrote to you in 1965, shortly before you went up to university, and I quote, "Dear Andrew, I have been told you're looking for a with-it writer of lyrics for your songs. I wonder if you consider it worthwhile meeting me." Wonderful. Can you recall your first meeting?
I can indeed. I can recall the first time I met Tim. I mean, this very, very tall, very blonde, rather, very skinny in those days, guy arrived at the door looking like some kind of Adonis. We really got on more or less as sort of friends and talking about pop. It wasn't for a few months before we actually decided to start work on an actual musical together.
But you went off to university, I think, a few months later, and, as I say, came down after a term.
I realised that there was nobody there who had a candle to Tim's lyric writing ability.
Really?
That was the thing. I mean, I basically left Oxford for Tim.
So Tim, in fact, as you said earlier, moved into the South Ken flat and the partnership began. And within 2 years, you'd written Joseph. Now, how did that come about?
Well, there was a guy who actually taught my brother, called Alan Doggett, who was a schoolmaster, and he wanted a piece for an end-of-term concert. It was 20 minutes long, Joseph, in those days. It was done on a wet Friday afternoon to a bunch of rather bored parents. But it went well, and so we did it again. And the critic of the Sunday Times, it transpired, now this is where luck does come in, had a child at the school. And, of course, the Sunday after that, we read this rave review for Joseph saying that Tim and Andrew are the new writers. And, we couldn't believe it. And so immediately we got an offer to write. And so that's how we got going.
And also music publishers, I think, in the meantime, bought Joseph from you. How much did they give you for it?
They paid £100 for it.
And in 1991, you bought it back.
For $1 million. I tell you, that was cheap.
Joseph was taken to Egypt in chains and sold, where he was bought by a captain named Potiphar.
Pity.
state of the British musical then, Andrew, when you and Tim began writing, second half of the 60s? We got Oliver.
Oliver was a big hit, and there were an awful lot of kind of sub-Olivers going on, you know, the sort of musicals that were about Cockneys in East London. Mm. It was not exactly a cauldron of exciting new things.
All those sort of 50s leftovers, I mean, the sort of gentle, but rather small-scale stuff like Salad Days and The Boyfriend and
so on. Yes, they'd sort of done their bit by that time.
Yes.
I suppose, really, the biggest musical in London at that time was The Sound of Music. That was massive, but that was, of course, American.
And then Hair came in from off-Broadway, this kind of rock protest stuff, Age of Aquarius. You knew, I mean, perhaps that gave you the inkling, did it, that you had to write something big and noisy, a rock opera.
Well, I suppose so. I mean, Hair, actually, funnily enough, was less of a rock and roll show than you might think. I mean, the songs were actually great, but it was just the whole way that it just happened to hit a nerve at the time. Mm. But I think Tim and I had really decided the direction that we wanted to go before that, really, you know, in many ways.
And what was that direction?
Well, we were writing a lot of pop songs together anyway, and none of them really saw the light of day much. But it didn't really interest us to sort of emulate anything that was going on in British musical theatre at the time.
But when you finally came to write Jesus Christ Superstar, I mean, it was so big. It was your first big, full orchestra and rock band mega mix, wasn't it?
Well, the actual song itself, which was the first thing which we recorded, it was a hell of a gamble, really. I'm amazed the record company put up the money because it was a big orchestra. It was basically Joe Cocker's Grease Band playing on it, and of course Murray Head, who wasn't known. And the funny thing about it was it wasn't a hit in Britain. It wasn't a hit in America, but it was a hit in enough funny countries like Holland and Brazil and things for the record company to say, well, look, we have made our money back on this. And then they took the gamble that they would record the whole thing.
As I understand it, you were about to write this piece that was going to kind of redefine the British musical, and you wrote it in 5 days in a little hotel in Herefordshire. Somewhere.
Went to the Stoke Edith House Hotel in Herefordshire, and I did 5 days is a bit of an exaggeration. We wrote the bare bones of it in that time, but in fact over the whole of the next year up till October when it came out, we were writing and recording and working on it.
I see that your next record is Shostakovich. Didn't he go to see Superstar at one point?
Do you know, I mean, it's an amazing thing. He was a huge fan of Superstars. He came over for the World Cup in 1966, and I got this note from him. But Julian, my brother, of course, was learning the Shostakovich cello concerto. Now, this, you see, is, in my opinion, it's the essence of rock and roll in serious music. Because in fact, all the stuff what you're going to hear is when he gets into sort of you could transpose that onto a rock band, and it would sound so contemporary, particularly today with all the new instruments and things one can use. And so, for me, this is I just think it's a marvelous piece of work. This is an absolute masterpiece.
Shostakovich playing the opening of Shostakovich's Cello Concerto No. 1 with the London Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Seiji Ozawa. Tim Rice has always said, Andrew, that you were more ambitious than him, that you were always determined to make more of a business of it than he felt he wanted to. Is that right?
I don't really know. I mean, I think Tim is in his own way. He's really quite driven too. But I just, as I said earlier, I just so love musical theatre and everything to do with it that, in one sense, it's it sort of is my life. I mean, there have been moments, you know, that like with everybody in anything like that, where you sort of get a bit down and you get depressed or you think something has not really worked out or you've been misunderstood or whatever. But I've had really such a great time in it that I guess having one's own production company is very valuable to me. Tim doesn't like that side of things. I can't see Tim ever getting involved with the producing. But I get involved with the creative side of producing. Now I've got myself back into my own company again, which I was sort of more or less excluded from for about 5 years. But now I've got it all back again. I've got a fantastic team who do all the business things for me.
Why did you buy your company back? I mean, you've done it kind of twice, just to sort of sum it up. You floated part of it on the stock exchange.
I made a terrible mistake, but partly it was to do with circumstances at that time, because the tax rates were so high that the real way you could do anything was by floating it, and you know, maybe on the, or having a company that you could float on the stock market. And it was a dreadful mistake for me to do, because in the end I only ended up with 30% of the company, you know, and we had to buy it back because it just wasn't working.
But I mean, fascinating, because of course you are the major asset of your company, so it's difficult to see how you could be forced. I mean, if you stop creating,
well, I mean, there was a moment when I thought, well, there are only two alternatives here. Either I stop and we just don't go on. And I mean, when my contract was coming to an end with the company anyway, and I just start up anew. And I thought to myself, well, morally, I can't do that. So if this is the way I feel, I better try and get the company back. And so that's what we set about doing. But in doing so, we had to have somebody who could bankroll us, frankly. And so we ended up with 30% of the company owned by Polygram. And it became difficult after a while. And anyway, this summer I was able to get it back. So
you bought yourself back out of Polygram as well. So now you own yourself again.
Yes, I'm heavily mortgaged but happy.
But you're your own master. You like being your own master, and you like being master of your material, because the other thing you do, as I understand it, is you control your material worldwide. You know, if there's a production of any of your shows anywhere in the world, it is with the same costumes, the same choreography, the same sets.
Well, not necessarily, but I mean, if you've got a production like The Phantom, for example, yes, that would be the case. And some shows, you different productions, you do sometimes want. But on the whole, it's true that we tend to control it pretty carefully.
Why can't you give people a free hand? Why can't you let something new happen?
You can. But, I mean, if you went to see The Phantom of the Opera in London you then wanted to go and see it in New York, I think you'd be displeased if it wasn't the same show, basically.
Forget these wide-eyed fears. I'm here, nothing can harm you. My words will warm and calm you. Let me be your freedom. Let daylight dry your tears. I'm here, with you, beside you, to guard you and to guide you. Say you need me with you here. beside you. Anywhere you go, let me go too. Christine, that's all I ask of you.
Tell me about your next record.
Well, this is a little bit of an oddball one, but I think it's one of the cleverest food and wine sketches ever written. It's John Cleese and David Frost doing something called Matters of Taste. And of course, my column in The Telegraph, when I wrote for 3 years, did their food reviews. And I mean, I love restaurants, I love food, and I love wine. And I think when you know that, you'll know why I think this is one of the cleverest sketches ever written.
Well, sir, you've tasted it. Now, can you tell us what it is?
Yes, certainly. It's a Chambord Musigny, Chateau bottled, 1953.
No, it isn't.
Isn't it? Oh, well, in that case, unless I'm very much mistaken, it's a Chablis.
Yes. You are very much mistaken.
Very good. John Cleese and David Frost in their sketch Matter of Taste, and that was recorded in 1966. You mention your food writing, Andrew, you know, and you obviously put an awful lot into the researching of it, eating in two or three restaurants every week or whatever. But your wife, Madeline, has said, you know, he keeps the pressure up on himself and we live and breathe whatever he's up to. That's the bottom line, isn't it? You're not a man who does anything by halves.
Well, I think she's quite glad that I've given up food writing now, but I did love it. I absolutely loved it, and I'm still on things like the Carlton Food Awards and all of that. I mean, I love food, I love cooking, and of course I love my wine.
Exactly, and you had a collection of that, and you love your art. You've got a collection of pre-Raphaelite art. You know, if you're going to do anything, it seems to me, you do it big, you go the whole hog. That's what you're like. I mean, people say perfectionist. It's not exactly that, is it?
I must say, it's dreadful at the moment. I was going through my wine, list. You know, when I did have the sale 3 years ago, nobody keeps saying, oh, poor Andrew's parted with his wine cellar. I've got more than I had when I sold it.
But what is it all about? Are you just acquisitive, or it just every time you do something, whether it's music, wine or art, you've got to do it all?
Well, the art collection, of course, is something quite different. I mean, I've been terribly, terribly lucky in that I love musical theatre, and it's made me, you know, enough money to be able to indulge in my other real passion, which is art and architecture. And I happen to love the Pre-Raphaelites from the time when I was at school, because I saw a lot of Victorian churches, which I was very keen on. And a lot of the glass and the fixtures and fittings are, of course, by Burne-Jones or Rossetti. And, of course, it wasn't much of a step to really go and get down to the Tate Gallery, which was, after all, round the corner from the school. And suddenly I was hooked. Mm. And, of course, in those days, Victorian art was considered to be absolute rubbish. If you ever wrote or dared to say that you thought the Burne-Jones Briar Rose collection was one of the greatest works of art in British history, I mean, you would be laughed at. But mind you, in respectable circles, so was Rodgers and Hammerstein. I mean, so I was laughed at on all fronts.
Well, you talk about being laughed at. You're not laughed at, but despite the fact that you have done so much, as we've said, championed the musical theatre, redefined it, brought it this great international success, there is an element of British society, the chattering class, isn't there, who find it impossible to be generous to you in that success?
Yeah, I don't know really quite why, because I think possibly it is, you know, that I'm not actually that public a person, and I don't do masses and masses of PR or anything, you know, so I don't sort of really worry about my image.
Mm. But it seems to me to be a kind of distaste for your populism, as far as your music is concerned. They are very sort of snotty about coach parties.
It's probably exactly the same way that I think you'll find that the serious art critics don't like and will never get the Pre-Raphaelites.
Mm.
The fact of the matter is that even in the dark days, you know, when Victorian art was considered to be worthless, if you went into the Tate Gallery, guess where the public were?
Mm.
In the, you know, always in the Pre-Raphaelite Gallery.
Absolutely. Record number 7.
Well, now, this one is something very, very dear to my heart. I'm incredibly impressed by what's going on with the writing in Bollywood. I think some really great pop songs coming out there, and Hindi pop, I think, is really happening. I mean, we've got on the one level, you've got Talvin Singh and people like that, who I think is superb. And I discovered one Saturday morning, I thought, this is a really fantastic tune in one of those obscure programmes. And all roads led to one man, whose name I'm going to get wrong in pronunciation, because every time I meet anybody from India, they always pronounce it differently. But this is a guy called A.R. Rahman. I think this guy is a genius. He produces and writes the songs himself. He's the most fantastic record producer, apart from anything else. But the melodies, I mean, they just pour out of this guy. And he writes 4 Bollywood movies a year. And, I mean, I could put together a programme on him, which would, I think, kind of surprise practically everybody. There's just great tunes. And there's a twist. They are Indian, and it's different. Mark my words, something will happen. It's becoming mainstream.
A.R. Rahman and Dilse Ray from the Heart. Are you going to commission him, Andrew?
Well, I just think he's a great writer. I mean, it's very, very hard to know which one of his to play, actually, because there's some other ones which are, you know, perhaps more melodic than that. But he's just such a fantastic writer. I'd like to commission him to do a musical, because he, as it's saying, he does 4 or so Bollywood movies a year. And I don't think he's ever really been given a chance to write something for himself.
And what about your work? Is there more to come?
I guess I hope so.
Hmm.
I mean, it's so funny how these things happen. When I finished Whistle Down the Wind, I sort of sat down to myself and I thought, well, hang on a moment. I've done now 2 more musicals than Rodgers and Hammerstein ever wrote. And am I really sort of banging on only because, you know, I feel I have to?
Mm.
But then you see, this is where things suddenly, you can never predict. I met Ben Elton. And Ben said to me, he said, would you ever consider writing an original musical? I said, well, yeah, you bet. And I'd happened to have seen a television programme on BBC about what happened to a bunch of kids in Northern Ireland who were playing football in the late 60s in Belfast. And I said to Ben, have a look at this. And Ben said, well, I don't want to do their story, but it's a hell of an idea to take the idea of something, you know, really, which is very much part of our time, and really write about how the troubles in Ireland affected these kids and in ways that they couldn't control. And I thought it was a fantastic idea because it's new.
Breaks my heart. I have never felt such sorrow. All the love I have, I leave with you. I once promised till death do us part, and yet I'll be gone tomorrow. Please believe me what I said. But when I go, I'm on my own. The path I walk alone. I face a bitter world with only memories to guide me. I care more than I have ever cared, yet I know that I am leaving you. All the love I have, I leave with you.
You're a father, you have a family. Your son needs you. Don't ignore him. Just to fight a war you cannot win.
I hope my son will be proud of me. When I fight, I'm fighting for him. Share the love I leave for you with him.
And so we all must pay the price for such a stupid sacrifice. Don't you understand that this won't end till we let it?
I'm gone, you know, I won't be back. Mine's a path that has no turning. Please believe me, what I said was true. That all the love I have, I leave with you.
This is the really difficult one, Andrew. If you could only take one of those records.
Well, you know, I think it would actually be Some Chanted Evening, because I really do think that's probably one of the greatest tunes of all time.
And your book, as well as the Bible and Shakespeare?
Well, now, again, you see, because of my love of art and architecture and all things connected with English architecture in particular, what I think I would like to do is to cut out the front of Betjeman's Collins Guide to Parish Churches, because it's this most fantastic essay, and paste it into Simon Jenkins's newly published book of the 1,000 Best British Churches, because it's so beautifully illustrated, and he's done a wonderful job on the description of the churches. It's fabulous. Ideally, of course, it would be great to combine it with a good food guide.
Oh, no.
So that, because nothing is better than, for example, going to, say, Ludlow, where you can go to the wonderful Church of St. Lawrence's, and there are seven great restaurants in the town.
What about your luxury?
Well, I think, you know, we might have to have a little bit of a herb garden, so it might have to be some cuttings, if I'm allowed to take that, of various herbs and garlic and things, so that if ever I was able to cook or flavour things, I could do it properly.
What about all the things you've ever written? I wonder if you have a favourite. It's difficult. A lot of people say that when you wrote Evita and you wrote Variations for Julian, which is used on the South Bank show, of course.
Yes.
Well, that was your most creative period.
That was the Paganini Variations, yeah. But I don't know. It's a deeply personal thing when one's thinking about one's own music. I'm very, very fond of The Phantom. There are lots of associations with The Phantom. I was married to Sarah Brightman at the time, and it was written really for her. But also, I suppose my Requiem Mass, which is a piece which I think I kind of got half right. I think when I got it right, I'm really quite pleased. But I think when I got it wrong, I'm really sometimes say I must rewrite this thing.
You wrote this when your father died.
But I wrote that really about the death of my father. And so I think if anything, perhaps Pia Jesu would be the piece of mine that I'm most fond of.
Thank you.
Andrew Lloyd Webber, thank you very much indeed for letting us hear your Desert Island Discs.
Thank you very much.